Chrysosporium opiatocola. Wow. So just the Chrysosporium species, or you can even call it CAND or whatnot. But Chrysosporium is a very, very nasty fungi that does very, very well eating keratin and tissue associated with reptiles. So we don't have a fungi that a snake can bask and kill it, and it can't get cold enough and kill it. So when a snake comes back to the den, goes underground, and the fungi is all colonized in the den, and is at it's you know the snake is first realizing temperatures of 60 degrees, 50 degrees, its immune system starts going right down. And because the animal doesn't have a chance to bask anymore, it's underground, it's sitting in kind of this wet place with a massive fungal attack, you know, overload, and the fungal spores, you know, in theory, are attacking the snake, they're damaging the snake, they're damaging the keratin and the waxy sheathing of the scale, you know, that protect the snake, and it's also going via heat pits in all areas in the mouth. As the snake starts crawling, they start getting in the gum line, they get these, you know, stomatitis, they get petechia and all these different things. And somehow it overwhelms the snake and we start creating these little sores. So it you know, probably initially is a superficial lesion. And the fungus gets through the first, you know, waxy layer of the outer dermal layer, and it starts getting deeper. And these fungi shoot these hyphae or whatever you want to like, these roots into the animal. And worst case scenario, the fungal infection becomes systemic. So it becomes bloodborne and spreads throughout the body and can attack different things in the snake. And the snake has no immune system when it goes into the den. And then it goes into now a very cold time where, you know, these rattlesnakes are, you know, often seeing 47 degrees down to 37 degrees. But there's a long time where they're, you know, anywhere from 42 to 55 degrees. And part of that temperature scope, the fungus is active. Then we start getting cold, let's say 50 degrees. And at 50 degrees, this fungus doesn't seem to be growing when we, you know, when we do cultures and try to grow the fungus and stuff like that. So it kind of just goes into just dormancy. So the snake is sitting there. It's hibernating, has very limited immune system, and it has these lesions, and everything kind of goes quiet. And then it's time for the snake, if the snake, you know, lives through this, you know, 4-month period of dormancy, it comes back to emerging, and it, once again, it starts seeing temperatures of the 50 degrees or better, and the fungus starts becoming active again. The fungus starts attacking. The snake still doesn't have an immune system. The snake starts initially coming out and basking. It has very short little periods of time where it's able to elevate its core temperature and bask. And those several occurrences are enough to start getting the metabolism going, where we ultimately get an animal that wants to feed and wants to go in a shed and stuff like that. So this whole time, its immune system is very, very limited. It's being, once again, attacked in theory by these fungi, and the animal comes out, and you have these animals that are covered in these gross lesions. And what's really interesting, it is so telling, these animals are coming out during the winter.
You know what this reminds me of? This is crazy. But this reminds me of the white nose syndrome with the bat.
It is. Exactly. That's called geomycete destruction of the bat.
Right.
And what that does is causes the bat to constantly groom itself. So these bats go into hibernation with these, you know, fat sores from all their summer feeding. And they need to, you know, we need to hold off and not use that energy while we're hibernating. Well, every time the bat wakes up, its metabolism kicks in. It's preening itself, dealing with this fungus that's like probably burning it and stuff like that and irritating it. And it basically exhausts all its fat that it would normally use throughout the winter. And then these, you know, within a short period of time, these bats are going through the fat. They're getting skinny. They're getting hungry. And they come outside, and they're flying around. It's wintertime. I remember being out one day just exploring this one den site, and I see a bat in the snow on the ground. And I was like, you know, you see it for a minute, just flip by, and I was just like, what? And, you know, this was already when I knew about, you know, white nose syndrome. And it's so real. I mean, you know, I grew up seeing bats all over the place. Bats are so rare. And then you always be able to see, you know, one or here and one or that. But you still look up and, you know, oh, there's six bats just winging around. You could take a plastic spoon and shoot up mealworms and feed that. But it is so much like that. And with a firm, absolute stance, it is fatal like that. You know, we have bat colonies up here in the Northeast that have been studied for seven years that are, you know,
collapsed.
No, and some of those colonies have zero bats.
They're collapsing, especially here on the East Coast. They seem to be collapsing like really fast. It's scary.
Yeah, total colony collapse, just like, you know, honeybees. And now we have these rattlesnakes that what they do in the fall, one of the things I was like watching them, like they're lingering. A lot of times, you know, rattlesnakes are, you know, they come back to the den, and unless they have a meal in them, they generally hang around a little bit and they go down. Females that have follicles are some of the first ones, in my opinion, that are going down into hibernation because they want to, you know, get this over with so they can come back out and start the reproductive process. There's no point in that female growing her ovum any larger than when she goes in. You know, she's going in, her follicles are probably 16 to 20 millimeters when they're going in. And I've learned a lot about rattlesnakes. I've really taken all my snake breeding stuff and I've projected on these animals, and I had a lot of, you know, questions, and I've been answering all these. So I'm learning a ton of self-taught biology about these rattlesnakes. But these rattlesnakes are lingering in the fall, and what they're doing is instead of going all the way down into the den, they go down just like underground for a little bit, and then you get a day, it's 45 degrees, and a lot of the snakes come back up and bask. They bask, and they're playing a very dangerous game.
Is somebody working on following this issue right now? I mean, is somebody working on following this issue? I mean, are people actually doing
it? I have been the monster. You know how many people I've made hate me? I've made so many people hate me because they didn't believe it, and I've gone, they're making up every excuse, all these different things. And luckily, I got the biologist in New Hampshire to warm up to me, and they're like, all right, this guy knows his stuff, and we're watching, you know, this colony decline. And then I have a friend that was seeing snakes, and, you know, he didn't know anything about rattlesnakes. And now his, you know, years later, you know, from 2006, 2007, nothing, to, you know, 2013, he is incredibly versed in rattlesnakes. He showed me pictures of snakes, like, the snakes are like, what? And I go, see all these sores on the face and all this different stuff? And I brought him up to speed, and he's a highly intelligent guy. So he's very intense on whatever he does. So with some of my guidance in the beginning and stuff like that, he's come up to speed, and he's been like my partner in crime. So we're described by a lot of these experts as nefarious. We're like the bad guys because we constantly keep... Whenever we talk to somebody, we're always going on about diseases, and all these people are like, ah, there's no disease and all this different stuff. Well, finally, they're like, oh, my God, there's a disease. And, you know, like my friend, okay, we have snow on the ground right now, and our winters are really kind of not so impressive as far as winters. You know, we get some snow, but it's, you know, and we get some warmer days. So my friend is out yesterday, and he goes to one of these dens that we know. And, you know, we're learning we can go snake hunting in the winter and we can go find six snakes. But every year there's less and less of these animals because they keep on dying. This is a highly fatal disease. So he went yesterday and he found a snake. And snake is, you know, suffering away, and it's got lesions all over its body and all different stuff. And ultimately that snake was collected, and that goes to, you know, we give these snakes to some of the people that actually are supposed to be getting these to try to do rehabbing and all that different stuff like that. Because my friend doesn't actually have permits. I have permits for this stuff, and I work with the state of, you know, New Hampshire and stuff like that. But, you know, you have to rely on these people, and you really have to win them over. And I've been very, you know, lucky to finally win over New Hampshire. We're you know, struggling with some of the other states, but they are starting to warm up, and now people are starting to like, Kevin, all right, we're understanding it. Now I'm starting to get involved in these conversations and whatever. I'll give you a very a good one. I go out to Minnesota. I do a talk on rattlesnake disease. I do the talk, and at the talk, there's two of equivalent, you know, like the Department of Natural Resources, they're biologist guys or whatever, guys that, you know, study the rattlesnakes and study other endangered species, and one of them being in Minnesota is black rat snakes. And so I see the disease in black rat snakes, I see it in black racers, I see it in milk snakes, I see it in all sorts of different snakes. Ringneck snakes, it kills snakes. And it, you know, we've done testing, and we've really finally got the right way to test it. Over and over and over and over and over again, over the years, they were testing it and they were missing it, because you have to know how to tickle out the fungus. It grows slowly. And if you don't do something called the PCR, and if you don't do it right and you don't tickle it out and you don't do the culture right, you will whiff, and you'll, you know, your plate will grow over with, you know, aspergillus or, you know, other, some kind of, you know, fungi, mold or whatever. So I go to Minnesota, I do a talk, these guys are there at the Herb Society, and you know, they're like, oh, you know, this is really interesting, but how do you know you're not the disease vector? And I'm like, I'm not. Well, how do you know that? And, you know, I have to listen to all this different stuff. You know, it's like we're talking about chytrids with frogs and all that, you know, horrible disease and whatever. And I'm like, no, it's there. I'm going to populations I've never been to, and it's there. And, you know, so, you know, the, you know, kind of one guy's a little bit more open-minded than the other guy. And then I start talking to him, he's like, well, I study the black rat snakes, and I'm seeing these black rat snakes that come out of the den. They get the sores on the face. We pit tag them, and we never see the snakes again. Like, yeah, that sounds like it. And they go, and they're dead. They, black rat snakes suffer horrible eye infections. They don't have the resilience like a big rattlesnake does. Young rattlesnakes don't have a lot of resilience either. So anyways, so one of my rewards for doing this lecture was to go out to a few of the rattlesnake populations. And out there, it's drier. It's, you know, it's definitely way colder. But it's, you know, here we get a lot of canopy growth. There they get much, you know, smaller, less canopy growth. And what's wonderful about their resources out there, they do habitat management. They take down bushes, they do burning, and they maintain these they're called goat bluffs. And these, like, hillsides with, like, all these limestone areas, and that's where the rattlesnakes are denning and stuff. So we go to a couple different places. And, you know, because it wasn't exactly the best time of year. We're going out in the summertime, essentially, early summer. So we finally go to the most pristine place that they could say. This was like the least disturbed area by man. And it was just, you know, way out in the middle of wherever. It's like a hunting lodge. And the guy that owns this piece of property buys this property for, like, hunters, and, you know, people can stay there and go hunting. And he maintains these fields and beautiful farmland. It's just, it's tremendous. And he finds out that there's rattlesnakes on there. This guy had no affinity for rattlesnakes. This guy was so open-minded. He's like, wow, rattlesnakes, and they're endangered or they're rare and all that. He starts working on the property and starts being kind to the rattlesnakes and starts, you know, burning it and doing stuff. And he learns to like rattlesnakes, and he comes out and he visits and stuff like that. So it's really cool. So anyways, so we go looking.
Kev, I got to cut you off because we're running out of time on the rattlesnakes really fast.
I just want to tell you, okay, so anyways, so I go out there. The guys don't think that they have the problem there. I look at some snakes and I go, hey, I think maybe your snakes do. I convince them to let me catch a couple of them. Catch a couple of them. They test them. They got it. And they were blown away because this place is perfect.
It can really affect anywhere. I mean, this is obviously an issue that's affecting populations.
This is a huge issue, Danny, and that's why I can just go on because I have so much information. But it kills snakes. They don't get better. Mm-hmm. They suffer, and it's unbelievable. So if anybody's going out and looking at dens and seeing snakes with sores, you can even go to your dens now and start looking. If there's no snow on the ground, there's areas where the snakes can bask, you might find a snake, and you better look at that snake very closely, document it with pictures, bring it to the authorities, let them see and go, look, you know, well, you know, this copperhead will crawl out into the snow and die, and all this different stuff. But if anybody's into rattlesnake, really, really should investigate it. Canopy growth is a huge problem. You know, you need to dry out the dens. You need to improve basking, all these different things. But it is very, very real, and people should at least investigate the possibilities that it's in their dens, and it kills these snakes so fast. Because, I mean, it's one den that I'm talking about, you know, maybe 60 plus animals. It has less snakes than on one hand.
Oh my god!
Over a few years.
Definitely something we're going to have to follow up on and find out more about to inform
you
guys.
Gears.
But we have to switch gears because we're running out of time fast. I got a lot of stuff to talk about. First off, I want to get Brian Potter on the phone. Let's grab him really quick and let's get him on.
Eating. I don't have all he does is eat. I'm serious. Yeah, I call him up. It's like hot dogs falling out of his mouth. He's snorting and drooling. Terrible. Don't even answer the phone, dude. Nachos are more important than you are.
Of course.
So he'll text me, dude, I'm eating. What do you want?
He's not picking up the phone. I'm eating, man.
Thanks, Brian.
You know,
hey, this is Brian. Go ahead and leave me a message as soon as I can. I told you.
Unreal.
Dude, it's Friday. They're having a 2-for-1 sale. Brian, you're fat. You're fat. Urban Jungle Radio's recognizes you're fat. Stop eating. Call us back. It's time to pay the fiddler.
Brian, give us a call back. Good Lord. 347-205-9407. Anyway, we'll try to get him back on. All right. I'm going to move on. Listen,
We don't need him.
We don't need him. I wanted to have him in on this because there was an important issue that he wanted to discuss. But that's fine. No. We need to discuss this because obviously there's a lot going on in the industry itself right now. You have been on top of this, obviously, since the get-go, fighting fronts on all sorts. We know what's been going on a little bit with USARC and all these other organizations. One of the organizations we haven't heard from yet, and we have really no information on almost, is PIJAC. And earlier today, I had a chance to speak with Mike Canning, the president and CEO of the CEO of PJAC, and he had some interesting things to say. So I want to address some points of concern with him, and we did that. And here's what he had to say. So just hang back a second, Kev. Well, Mike, thank you for joining me. This is, of course, Mike Canning from PJAC. Mike, can you just give us a little bit of info about PJAC for those who might not be familiar with it?
Sure. PJAC is a 40-year-old trade association made up of a wide variety of pet businesses and individual hobbyists. We represent product distributors, product manufacturers in the pet industry, live animal producers, coming from about 5 different categories, reptiles, fish, dogs and cats, small mammal, and birds. And then also we represent a bunch of breeders of those. We represent stores, mom and pop pet stores all across the country, as well as some of the larger stores. So that's our basic constituency.
Yes. I mean, PJAC has actually been very involved from what I know in fighting in the reptile industry, especially when it comes to legislation. Can you talk about just maybe some of the campaigns that PJAC is involved with as far as legislation goes or anti-pet legislation?
Yeah, absolutely. We first thing about PJAC is that we, for the entire pet industry, we track over 17,000 bills every year.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have enough time to go manufacture a reptile fight in a state. So right. you'll never find PJAC going into a state that doesn't have any regulation and see us proposing regulation. We don't do that. And that's important to know.
Right.
And so what we do though is if we find out about through our monitoring services and our monitoring systems, if we see that there's a reptile bill out there or an exotic animal regulation pending somewhere, we will get involved because we don't want to see any animals that people love as pets being banned. PJAC has a strict opposition to any bans of any pets. And that includes large constrictors, monitors, spiders, tarantulas, and items like that.
Yes.
We just don't believe that banning those pets is a good idea because those pets are good pets for someone.
I mean, I think PJAC has historically kind of been viewed as an industry advocate, leaning more towards, some people would say the bigger box stores, according to popular opinion, especially these days amongst reptile hobbyists. Are you guys making any sort of effort to reach out to the smaller breeders and suppliers in the industry?
Well, we think that it's important, and we think that every part of the pet industry is connected, because obviously if we can reach out to small breeders, help them with some of the difficulties they're having, and basically allow them to be more effective in selling their animals to hobbyists and people that want to have pets. Well, big box stores are going to benefit from that anyway, because you know, the person that buys a corn snake is going to need caging and stuff like that, and the corn snake may come through the mail, UPS, but then they're going to have to go somewhere to get the caging, the food, and the habitat. And so they're going to go to either a mom-and-pop store, or they're going to order it online, or they're going to go to one of the larger retail outlets. And so everyone benefits. And that's one thing that's really cool about the pet industry, is that if a live animal is sold or propagated, good things happen with the other people that make supplies for the maintenance of that pet.
Right.
So what we do to try to reach out with a smaller breeder, we go to a lot of shows, reptile shows, and then we also work on best practices that try to make sure that people have the knowledge and the education to take care of their pets better and to be safe from the small degree of chance that maybe there's some salmonella floating around, you know, how to prevent those type of things. And so that ultimately makes the reptile work better for the small breeder.
Now, can we just talk about best practices for a moment? I know that's something that a lot of people are concerned about. People tend to feel that best practices almost fall into a method of, you know, you have to do this for your animals by law. I mean, can you just explain what best practices actually are?
Sure. Best practices are voluntary collections of really good information put together by experts. One of the problems that we have in the reptile world is that we always seem to be on the brink of suffering the repercussions of the latest potential disaster. And we don't have that many disasters in the reptile world, but the ones that could occur are so horrendous that it could have very negative repercussions through legislation when legislators and government people try to clamp down after an accident. I mean, after this shooting in Connecticut, well, what's happening now?
Right.
They're clamping down on what they feel are the mechanisms that they think cause this tragedy. And so to the extent that we would ever have a tragedy in the reptile world, there would be that kind of backlash from government decision makers. So what we want to do is we want to put out education before those kind of things could happen, educate people on how to confine their larger constrictors or their poisonous snakes better, and so that maybe we can try to prevent accidents from happening. And so those are best management practices. They're voluntary, and basically what they are a bunch of good and smart people in the reptile industry sharing their many years of information and expertise with other people that might not have the education about how to do certain things as good, in an effort to really protect the industry.
Yeah, I agree. I think very often, especially in the reptile industry, when it comes to keeping, you know, venomous animals or potentially dangerous animals, we are often our own worst enemy in a sense, because, you know, for as much good and the people do in keeping their pets, and as responsible as they may be, all it takes is the acts of just one person, you know, acting irresponsibly, and that is unfortunately what usually catches the public's attention. So I think it's a great idea to have, you know, a guide in the very least out there for those seeking to do it properly. Now, I know some people have voiced concerns that PJAC has been associated with the Humane Society, which historically has worked against small breeders and even hobbyists. What can you say about those with concerns about PJAC's affiliation with the Humane Society of the United States and how it would affect, you know, someone keeping small animals at home?
Yeah, recently we've had a small dialogue with the Humane Society of the United States around the issue of dog breeding. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would not consider that we're working with anybody, that we have an alliance with anybody. It's merely a conversation, and the conversation is aimed at putting a definition on a puppy mill. And the reason we thought it was important to do that, and our board thought it was important to do that, is because we cannot support good breeders without making some kind of determination of what a bad breeder looks like. And so we came up with this definition of a puppy mill, and it's only a sentence. If I could read it to you.
Sure, absolutely.
Then maybe I can, maybe then I can make the point of why it was important to do this. The definition of a puppy mill: a dog breeding operation which offers dogs for money, monetary compensation, in which the physical, psychological, and or behavioral needs of the dogs are not being fulfilled due to inadequate housing, shelter, staffing, nutrition, socialization, sanitation, exercise, vet care, and or inappropriate breeding. And so now we have that definition, and I don't know anybody, any responsible member of the pet industry that could stand and say, no, we believe that those requirements should not be met by somebody breeding dogs. And so it was important to get that out there, because now we can go and we can see, all right, if a breeder is not doing those and refuses to improve to the point where they will take care of a dog's nutritional or psychological or veterinary care needs, then they should be put out of business, because they are the bad actors in our industry, and they're making good breeders look bad. And so we can't have that, because then all breeders will be subject to, you know, the type of campaigns that the Humane Society runs.
Yeah. No, agreed. I think, you know, once again, another way of protecting, you know, our industry, our hobby, is in fact cleaning up our own backyards, especially, you know, a little bit of self-policing will go a long way, I think, before another organization with more extreme views like the Humane Society would need to step in and give their input in these situations. So that's something I could definitely understand.
If I could expand a little bit on that, because this is a really important point.
Please.
Thank you so much. Because now that we have this definition, the pet industry by itself is going to go out to dog breeders and other state associations and try to work on actual standards, you know, best management practices and standards that, again, spreading this information to other breeders that may not have knowledge of what really works and what they could implement to really take care of dogs well. And therefore, if the whole industry improves, anybody that needs to improve, that is, there'll be less pressure from the animal rights groups to try to shut down breeders. If they believe we're cleaning up our own act, they'll have less to do. And that is the key. We want to try to take the pressure off of all sorts of breeders by increasing standards so that there's actually less that the animal rights people are concerned about.
Absolutely. Mike, great points, and I want to thank you very much for joining us and talking to us about this. I think these are issues that people often hear about but don't really understand completely, and I think you've definitely helped to shed some light on that.
Well, thanks a lot, and I would like to say to all the herp people out there, I grew up with snakes, with some dogs, but mainly with snakes, and so I consider myself one of you. They're my favorite pet animals, and I'll always do what I can to make sure that you can own whatever pet you think is right for you, and also try to make sure there's information available so that you can do the best with your pet as possible. So thanks very much for having me.
Okay, now you said that, I'm going to put you on the spot. Favorite snake?
My favorite snake?
Yes.
It's got to be the corn snake, because that's kind of what I had nice. Growing up. But that doesn't mean that I wouldn't appreciate a nice green tree boa.
Well, now we know for what...
Green tree python, I mean.
Green tree python. Now we know what to get you for Christmas, Mike.
Yeah. Give me that chondro, man, because I'm a chondro guy.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I like the green snakes myself quite a bit. Well, there you have it, Mike Canning. PJAC, what do you think, Kev?
It was great. Really good, because this whole thing started when, you know, I'm hearing all this, PJAC's aligning itself with HSUS and all this different stuff. I'm hearing this stuff, and I'm like, all right, I don't know what I'm thinking, because I know when we do the auctions for NARBC, you know, half the money is going to PJAC, so I'm like, you know, we're going to get the money and get to them, and I need to understand what actually is going on with PJAC. So I was like, go call my name. And I loved the guy when I met him. He was just, you know, just decent guy, willing to talk to you. I called up, took my call, spent over an hour talking to him. And I was really, you know, kind of worried, you know, what I was gonna hear. The moral of the story is he is a tough guy. He's very forthright. He is, the most wonderful thing is he's very open-minded. Mm-hmm. He does not, if I criticize something, I we could probably do this better. He's like, hey, that sounds great. And we basically talked about forming a steering committee. Mm-hmm. And what PJAC is talking about doing now is to take some people from our industry that are aware of our current needs and our current worries, and we create a little committee of us. And then every 4 to 6 weeks, we have these conference calls, and basically we get PJAC talking our language. We get them up to snuff. And then we also can act like liaisons, and we can say, hey, this is what's going on with PJAC and stuff like that. Obviously, they're very good at what they do. And what we want to do is to get them more aware of our particular needs. And, you know, there's incredible expertise within our industry. And if they're treating us, you know, like maybe, you know, what they could have treated us back in like the 90s, we need to get them current. So when I started looking at the best management practices, I got, somebody might have seen this being put out there. I'm not happy with the best management practices that they have right now. And I express this, Mike and I have been going back and forth. The guy's great. I annihilate him with emails and he responds right back, never cops an attitude or anything. And, you know, I want to get this a little bit more current where, Danny, if you were to read it, and I certainly read it, and I was like, this sounds like it's written by a retired, you know,
biologist. Yep.
Or whatever. Yep. And indeed, I think a lot of it is.
Yeah.
And it doesn't talk smoothly to us, where it makes me worried, some of the verbiage and stuff like that. And one thing that I just can't seem to let go of is, we start talking about best management practices of, you know, potentially dangerous constrictors and venomous. Venomous is its own thing. I don't want to ever include large constrictors and venomous in the same sentence. That's just like Wayne Purcell including boa constrictors and tigers in the same sentence and then lying to everybody and telling them that they grow over 20 feet long.
Wait.
This is, you know, it's terrible. So we must define this stuff with PJAC, you know, dangerous or whatever. You know, the idea is good. We need to regulate and educate ourselves, and that's why this whole grain thing is going to ultimately be important. But we need to police ourselves. We need to sharpen up and just kind of like go, hey, the things that, like, how I present myself with my pet and what I do, it ultimately affects all of us. So if I go out there and, you know, whip around a snake and the snake, you know, bites a little kid because I was acting like a total moron and I freaked out the snake, that would reflect on everybody. And, you know, my moment of irresponsibility would reflect on other people. So we can take the best management practices and tweak it. And they're open-minded to it and stuff like that, which is great. But what's interesting to me, they have best management practices of reptiles, but they don't have best management practices of dogs.
Right. More common. No, you see, here's the thing. Everybody panics about the best management practices, which is why I asked about them. People tend to take them as, you know, rule. Excuse me. And they're not. They're not, you know, necessarily rule. They are open to suggestion. And I think the most important thing to note here is the fact that PJAC is now open to a discourse with reptile keepers, whereas before they weren't. I mean, before we didn't have any cooperation between PJAC and between USARC. And
I think that was our own failures.
That was, you know, that was
literally was one or a few people, you know, ruining it for all of us.
Right.
And I think as bad as things have come and how disjointed and how upset we are, this is actually a really good opportunity for us to take pause, collect our thoughts, kind of figure out what we need to do. PJAC is incredible. So anybody that's out there sitting there with a stupid HS U.S. stuff and, you know, saying that there's, you know, alignment or anything like that. It's very simple. Mike Cannon says HSUS is against puppy mills. PJAC is against puppy mills. Basically, dog Auschwitz.
Right.
All of us are naturally against that. So if I'm against it and PJAC's against it and HSUS, then we're all in some conspiracy. And ultimately, PJAC gets money from people that support them. For PJAC to turn its back on anybody that aligns themselves against the practice of these puppy mills, you know, in a really, you know, real bad practices, PJAC would have a problem with the people that support them. So that literally is it. There right now is 10 or 12 campaigns from PJAC against HSUS.
Right.
So they're not suddenly being friendly. They engage in one conversation saying, PJAC needs to know what are the standards that you consider one of these horrific puppy mills.
Well,
so
you know what a lot of
we
people
need
don't...
to remove ourselves, any of their dog breeders that they support. They need to remove themselves of anybody that falls within those parameters. So
right.
naturally, they have to talk to one of the biggest critics, which is HSUS. But people within our industry doing this conspiracy theory stuff and all this different stuff, they need to stop it. Take that energy and let's do something positive with it. Let's stop talking about Andrew Wyatt and what Andrew Wyatt did. I know tons. And everybody makes mistakes, everybody, whatever. Is Andrew inherently bad? No, I don't think so. He's done a lot of good things. Were some mistakes made? Yes. And whatever. But if we keep whining about it and whatever, we're not worrying about what's in front of us. We're worrying about like what's now, why things in front of us are changing. We need to take our opportunities. We need to collect ourselves. I think U.S. ARC is going to come out. It's going to be stronger. But U.S. ARC is very flawed. There's going to be room for improvement. They realize it. There's literally going to be a board where there's collective thoughts, collective ideas about what U.S. ARC is going to do with all their energy. Thank God for, you know, Gary Bagnall and Todd Goodman from, you know, that are basically the heart and center of U.S. ARC. These two guys have made money in our industry. They're turning around and supporting us.
Well, look,
because our industry supported them and built them. People have to realize they are throwing money at it with really no, there's nothing in it for them except for they like a good fight and they believe in it. But when we start including things and, you know, taking down Facebook and saying I'm going to, you know, boycott an NARBC for the raffles and all this different stuff, I really don't understand what they're doing for all of us. And I want everybody to keep any kind of animal possible that, you know, is within reason. So even if it's reptiles, amphibians, anything like that, I don't keep. It's very important for me to fight for those people if I'm giving an opportunity to fight. And that's really what I'm doing. I'm trying to, because I guess I guess people are looking up to me or whatever. And so ultimately, I feel like, you know, it's some of my responsibility. If I have people that believe in me, then I'm going to try to do the best I can. And that's why, Danny, you see me doing whatever I do.
Yep.
It's like we need to focus our ideas. I'm learning a ton right now, but I have a lot of really good ideas. Obviously, I'm not going to be able to really get to at this time. But I think we do need to support U.S. ARC. I think we do need to support PJAC. I'm not even saying don't support Andrew Wyatt's new thing, because it all collectively can do something good, and there's going to maybe something else comes out in just a while. But if we sit within ourselves and we create this turmoil, we're a bunch of idiots and we're going to be isolated. We need to realize that we are one single community, and I mean amphibians, inverts, and all that different stuff. And the frog people don't care if the ball python people can't keep snakes. A lot of them, some of them do, but a lot of them probably, yeah, doesn't affect me. That is so poor. I don't even want to sit here and publicly tell you why that's poor.
Right.
I can support that, why that's a really bad way to think, because all the stuff is indeed interconnected. Just think about the NRA. They don't just fight for handgun owners.
No.
They fight for all different gun owners, and they've become, you know, massive, although, you know, this recent shooting has really knocked it down. We have to cooperate, and we got to all be part of the community.
Absolutely. Words of wisdom from Kevin, everybody. One more time for Kevin McCurly.
Thank you, Kevin.
No, Kevin, you're absolutely right. Good points all the way around. I think the best bet right now is to basically go around and organize and support every organization and see, you know, who does what. And obviously then focus your resources on the organization that best suits, you know, what you require from them. But I think at this point that we're at right now, this juncture, we need unity. That's definitely the issue. There's a severe lack of it in every way, shape, and form. And I think right now we need to work on that first and foremost, and then everything else will hopefully over time fall in place. It's a pretty sticky situation out there, but I think right now we just need to get our shit together and get together. Kevin, thank you so much for coming by and stopping and talking to us about Rattlesnakes. I know there's definitely not enough time to talk about everything we needed to get in. But
we have plenty more things. I'm going to just put one little point.
Go ahead.
Right now, probably a very good idea for us to be conscientious how we appear to the public. So, you know, videos of snakes, you know, doing things, eating things, whatever, all that kind of stuff that makes our industry not look so kind and makes us look like the weird monsters that, you know, people want to portray. So, like, if it's a forum and it says, you know, man-eaters, when they're talking about, let's say, large pythons, we need to change the man-eaters part. If we're a forum or a Facebook page and everybody's constantly swearing and they're showing, you know, a lot of feeding, and there's some, I love rats. I love rodents, so I'm very aware of other animals. And if we make ourselves look like bloodthirsty, you know, whatever, it isn't good for us. Very sensitive times, and I wish people just take that to heart. Just think, what you're doing really can affect all of us, and I do not want to lose my abilities, nor do I want anybody else. So we have to be a little bit more cautious and intelligent with what we're doing.
Absolutely. Yeah, good words to leave by. And for sure, I think the next couple months are going to be an interesting time for us in the industry and what direction we take. Kevin, thanks so much for coming by the show and giving us some input on these important topics. We'll be sure to be watching you on Nerd, and you're doing the whole show circuit and all that good stuff. So we'll see you around, man.
Hey, guys. Bye,
brother. Take be care, good. Kevin all McCurly, right, everybody. Yay. Kevin McCurly, everybody, from Nerd. Yay. All right. Yeah, so make sure, okay. So make sure we're clear here, because I don't even know what the hell I'm doing.
He always has so much to say. It, you know, I love Kevin. You know, the couple times that we've met him at NARBCs, he just has so much to say, and his enthusiasm is, you know, contagious.
Yeah,
it
Kevin,
really is.
Enthusiasm is somewhere where Kevin definitely never fails to fall short.
No, not at all.
Oh, good Lord, Andy, what the hell happened tonight, man?
I don't know. I don't know. I thought we had everything lined up. You know what, man? Technical difficulties aside. What a way to ring in 2013. No? Anyone else agree?
Yeah.
Can I get some applause or something?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Here we go. Wait. There we go. Yeah, essentially the night was a rude awakening in how quickly we need to learn our technology here. But for the most part, it went a lot like, and somehow I think towards the end it will end up working out. But yeah, man, a lot to be said, a lot to digest. You know, there's definitely some stuff going on. We have USARC, PIJAC, USHA, whatever, Herp Alliance.
Usha?
I don't. USHA, is that the U.S. Herp Alliance? U.S. Herp Alliance? USHA.
I don't know.
I'm assuming it would be USHA. So USHA, the Herp Alliance, however you want to call it. These are all options. These are all options that we have out there, obviously, and options that you want to explore, because right now we need every dog in the fight. So don't get swayed by all the bullshit going on the side. There's a lot of personal stuff being thrown out there, obviously, and it shouldn't affect what we as a whole organization are trying to achieve here as a group. So I don't know, going forward, I hope that you guys have some inkling of what's been going on and understanding, and kind of now know what direction to take. I don't know. I don't even know if I really know what direction we're taking right now. Let me put my mic down, because I'm done with my pop star.
posing.
All I know is, like Kevin said, we need to start taking responsibility for our own actions. Stop posting, you know, your Savannah monitor eating some pinkies off of your carpet. Stop posting your rattlesnake being handled by you in your hand. It doesn't help us. It, you know, it's a cool video. I can't disagree with that. I mean, personally, I don't mind, you know, feeding of live animals. It doesn't bother me one iota. But there are plenty of people that do, and there are a lot more people outside of our hobby that despise the fact that we do it. But yet, they'll continue to eat hamburgers and chicken and fish.
Yeah.
I mean, their argument is it's not alive. Okay, so I'll kill my my mouse and give it to my snake or my Savannah monitor. Does that change it? Not really. It doesn't really change it. I mean, you know, everything has to eat something. And, you know, that's one side note. But Kevin said we need to start taking responsibility. And that's what needs to happen. We need to stop the infighting. We really do. You know, who cares if you like ball pythons? Who cares if you like king cobras? Who cares if you like beaded lizards? It shouldn't matter what snake, reptile, lizard, even arachnids now need to start being, you know, lumped into this, like Mike was saying.
Yeah, I mean, everybody really needs to join the fight. People have no idea, like, our scale of operation is so small. We're such a small fish in this pond, and we have a huge battle ahead of us, and the small fish are not going to get anywhere by sitting here and pecking at each other, that's for sure. You know, we need to wake up. Right now is the worst. Right now we are in that situation where we are basically infighting, and we are so busy concentrating on our own infighting that we're not really seeing the fact that we appear weak to everybody else.
Oh, absolutely. Right, absolutely.
And this is the time for attack. So this is dangerous. We got to get over this phase really fast. We got to get over this phase really fast, and we got to start getting with, you know, moving forward and protecting ourselves properly, fighting all these, you know, all this pending legislation that's coming down in tubes. And fine, you guys can nitpick, you know, back and forth on who's siding with who. But ultimately, if somebody is showing any inclination whatsoever on siding with us or helping us in our battle, we need to take advantage of whatever it is they have to offer. And I'm not saying go to bed with Humane Society or PETA, but, you know, don't be stupid about stuff. Like, keep an open mind. You know, remember, this is a political game here. Even ourselves dealing with rattlesnake roundups. Yep. You know, we called the Humane Society, and I'm not to say that if they would have offered help, I wouldn't have taken it, because ultimately what matters is the goal, you know, the focus at the end of the tunnel there. And whatever it is you're focused on, you need to achieve your goal, and you need to finish it. And if it means sometimes laying in bed with the enemy just to get that little, you know, bit of success or that bit of you know, a leg up, then be it so. It doesn't mean you have to conform. It doesn't mean you're an HSUS supporter. It doesn't mean you're a PETA supporter. Just use the pawn, man. Use the pawn to win the game. That's all what it basically comes down to, essentially.
The pawn is the strongest piece in an HS match.
It is true. All right. Well, I think we should probably start winding down here, Andy. Jesus Christ, I am kind of getting to the point where I just want to end the show, because none of our planning has
gone. 90 seconds.
And there's the 90-second mark anyway. So I want to thank our guest this evening, Kevin McCurley, for joining us. Obviously, you are Jungle Junkies. Thank you guys for joining us. Andy, thank you for being here, of course. And all of our listeners, you guys, we would be absolutely nowhere without you. I promise the next shows will be a lot more smoother than this. Please let us get through our growing pains as necessary. But coming up, it's nothing less than awesomeness in ways that you had no idea imaginable. Seconds. So stay tuned, hang in there, and thank you guys for everything. Andy, thanks, brother.
Thank you, my man.
Be good.
You too.
Oh, Andy, should we play? Wait. Oh, no. I'm not going to play that. I don't think they're ready for that, Andy.
No, don't play it.
All right. Let's do some Urban Jungle Style. All right. See you guys later. Oh, no. I'm going to do bat touch. I haven't done that. Okay, bye. I pushed the Jurassic Park music off. I think that's a great idea. A very little one.
10 seconds.
Should I slam the mic, Andy?
I'm out.
sweat, Andy sweat, Andy making a prank call. Me and you do all kinds of shit in jungle, junkies love it all. Now put your hands in these sacks, and I'll bet you feel balls. Yes, I'm Danny, yes, he's Andy, and Bob Irwin takes my call. You've had enough of snake roundups, reporting is rough from roundup towns. But we got that motherfucker covered like my Waffle House hash browns. Coming quicker than FedEx, delivering snake sex, Ben Siegel slams make me inclined to check on my computer for the next Urban Jungles Radio time. You and me, baby, ain't nothing but mammals, so let's listen to Urban Jungles. Fuck the Discovery Channel.
Andy doesn't want to dance. I'm dancing. Come on, Andy. Come on, Andy. Woo! Dance!
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
The kind you clean up with a mop and bucket, like Brian Barczyk's ponytail. Only God knows where he stuck it. Conservation, no need to be impatient. I wanna be down in your Everglades, catching up some pythons, fighting for to rely on. The UJR legend never fades. So live broadcast on the interwebs, and you know it's going to be tight. Just turn me on, cause I'm the Beastmaster.